What's up, guys? TW Booty Hunter here with another video, with another reaction video. The thing about this video, before I do anything else, before I even play it, I have been legitimately kind of just almost fighting with myself on how to approach a video like this, how to do a video like this. And the best way that I could think of is just doing a reaction video, because as you're about to see in this reaction video, this video is really good. This video is so great. Now, mind you, unlike most of my reactions, I have watched this video before. And as you can see from literally the like right here, I've watched this video before, which I guess is taboo in reactions. But the difference is, when I first watched it, I watched it just as someone who had not watched Gray Matz's content before or anything like that. I'm watching this now as a form to not only watch it again, but give my thoughts, because that's something I couldn't do on the initial watch. So this is basically it's going to be like right now, just to give an overall, you know, consensus or warning or whatever. I have reacted to this before, so don't expect this to be like a first time reaction. No, it's not. It's not going to be anything like that. So just want you to know that before going in, this is not a blind reaction. This is just me watching this video again and giving my thoughts. All right, let's do it.
I think it's fantastic. I think the more people are cross-pollinated between different musical styles, it not only has musical implications, but it has cultural ones as well.
Over the last couple of decades, a fair amount of music genres have been subjected to needless hate and strangely bad reputations. While, to be fair, many of these do have their faults, there are a fair amount of genres that are unfairly beaten into the ground. And I can think of no better example than the once radio-dominating sound of nu metal, a genre that defined the late 90s in all of its edgy, cheesy glory. And while the nu metal scene is no stranger to cash cow industry plants and bland copy-paste artists, it's also one that's bred countless amounts of innovations that are still heard in music today. The genre itself has been the unfairly beaten...
Facts. And before he goes on, I know this is like 57 seconds in the video, but that's one of the things that people forget a lot about nu metal, bro. Nu metal is like one of the most innovative genres in all of rock music, all of rock and metal, because there's been no genre before or even since that has even done half of the innovative stuff that nu metal has done. And I'm sure he's about to explain this in full form in this video, but I just wanted to kind of throw that out there for anyone that thinks that all nu metal was just a bunch of white guys rapping, and no, it really was not, dude. It was not a genre full of M&Ms with guitars, for fuck's sakes.
Dead horse of quote-unquote bad music for quite a long time. We've all seen the hit piece articles and videos denouncing the genre as a whole long time. Fairly beaten dead horse of quote unquote bad music for quite a long
time. And the thing about this is not to pick on Fantano, but the thing about music critics like this, when they criticize nu metal, I'm almost sure that they probably only listen to their form of what nu metal is Nookie by Limp Bizkit. Or fucking Papa Roach. Yeah, or Papa Roach or Rage Against the Machine. Something like that. Like, they haven't really listened to, like, some of the artists that really legitimately make that genre.
Long time. We've all seen the hit piece articles and videos denouncing the genre as a whole.
Hello, guys. Today we will talk about the abomination of music, nu metal.
Okay, first off, I'm telling you right now, I know that I'm not the only person who feels this way, but videos like that with that AI generated content, like not AI generated, but AI generated voice, you know, that computerized voice, I don't take seriously at all, ever. You just can't, because it's like, to me, videos like that are almost, and it's probably pretty harsh, but videos like that, as soon as I hear that computerized voice, I'm like, this is garbage already. Already this is garbage. I don't know if it's the fact that these people are so afraid of what their own voice sounds like, that they do this type of stuff, but it I find it to be the most cringe thing ever. It just always is, man.
It's the worst style of music ever, and everyone who likes it is a complete retard.
The hate train has been so thoroughly played out by now that even some of the genre-defining acts have gone out of their way to rebrand themselves as.
And then, for example, see, and the thing that about, like, you know, guys like Chino Moreno and stuff like that, it's like, it's like this comment, don't be embarrassed for liking nu metal, even if it's dumb music. I mean, it's one thing to not like a genre, you know, like not like to be associated with it, but it's like, dude, how is it dumb music? And this is also just a very disingenuous comment. Like, this is like very condescending, and this is like, this is one of the things that, as much as I love Deftones, I've also hated about Deftones, especially Deftones fans. They act like, because they listen to Deftones, that they're like music savants, that they're better than everyone else, that they're these like high class people because they listen to Deftones or something. And yeah, the thing about like how that's the thing. It's just like the way that, like, it's like, just because you listen to Deftones does not make you like high class of a music fan. Like, that's the one thing about Deftones fans. Like, I'm sure that they get memed about and all that stuff. It's because it's true. Deftones fans are like that, and apparently even Chino Moreno is like that. As much as I like Chino Moreno as a frontman. Just a really condescending comment here. Just like what you like. Who cares? Apparently you do. Enough to call it dumb music. But, eh.
Alternative metal. But let's just take a step back and ask ourselves honestly here. Is nu metal really that bad? Or is it actually kind of good? In recent years, the stigma has been slowly beginning to fade, with more and more bands across all of heavy music and even hip-hop taking some major influence from the genre. And oh, I'm here to definitely. Say once and for all, nu metal was never bad, and honestly, it was kind of amazing. Mm-hmm. So let's dive into the trenches and talk about nu metal.
God, Mercury, we're intense as hell. I'm glad they're back together.
They use force to make you do what the deciders have decided you must do. They use force to make you do what the deciders have decided.
One thing about Rage Against the Machine is you may not like their politics, or, I mean, yeah, even if you don't like their politics, even if they are total grifters, they've made some really great music.
You must do.
Nu metal as a genre is often credited as being started by the band Korn. While I do agree that they were one of the first and biggest to do the sound, nu metal's roots are actually a lot more interesting than just
exactly.
One band from a shithole like Bakersfield.
Like, it did, like, even though they were like the most popular, like they were the first to do that type of sound. Yeah, man, it's like, it goes so much deeper than Korn. Like, you just don't know. Luckily, he's about to tell you right here.
If I stop pausing the video long enough.
If we were actually going to dig up the roots of the genre, they're deep-seated in quite a few different sounds and underground scenes. And this is no real surprise given how diverse the genre sound can actually be. Despite what clickbait farms like Metal Sucks might have you believe, the genre is a lot more.
Dude, if you get your takes from Metal Sucks, I hate to say it, but you suck. Because metal sucks, obviously.
More than just tacky rap metal.
That rock band with the DJ?
Yeah! That's us, motherfucker.
Somebody tell this band what year it is.
Its origins can actually be found in places like alternative rock, grunge, industrial, hip-hop, groove metal, and even funk. Just think about the bands most associated with the sound. Korn, Linkin Park, Deftones, Limp Bizkit, Slipknot, Orgy, System of a Down. Aside from maybe two of those bands, could you really stick most of them in a rap metal box?
Exactly.
I didn't think so.
That's why I don't get why people think of like nu metal as just rap metal. Like, really? It's like, because you damn sure can't, any of those bands that you just mentioned, you damn sure cannot stick in that box. Like, not really, at least. Hell, you damn sure can't stick fucking Static X in that box. You can't stick Orgy in that box or Dead's Eye. Like, yeah, nah. Definitely can't. But, whatchamacallit? Yeah, man. I don't even know what I'm going to say. Let's just get back to the video.
Oh, and before some fat Redditor cries in the comments about System of a Down and Deftones not being nu metal, they've been deeply associated with and even seen as stars of the genre long before people started lumping them in with the term alternative metal. Now, if I were to actually point to the bands I think paved the way for nu metal, it would be Rage Against the Machine, Ministry, Suicidal Tendencies, and anything involving Mike Patton.
Yeah,
all of these
literally.
Bands were genre-bending artists in their
the
own right, with Rage Against the Machine showing just how well rock...
Matter of fact, I'm not going to lie, I wish I would have thought about it for this week. Or I don't know. I wish I would have thought about it for this week, but maybe next time. Top 10 awesome on Mike Patton. Definitely happening. Just putting that out there.
Rock and hip-hop go together.
Or top 10 rules. No shelter. Shade, I lick shots at the brutal charade. Ass or balls
closed like a casket. Our truth devoured, silent play in a shadow of power. Ministry taking synth pop, metal, and industrial and creating a sound wholly unique to them. And Suicidal Tendencies being the crossover thrash band. The underground and at times even mainstream level success of these artists created an interesting moment in music during the late 80s and early 90s. With many artists now finding more and more favor with audiences when experimenting with sounds previously thought to not go together. This all created a perfect storm for a new generation of artists to take all these building blocks and create a more cohesive sound all on its own. But before I get ahead of myself, I think it's important to talk about the previously mentioned Mike Patton. Oh, yeah.
This guy and all
Mike
of rock and
is
metal.
A name I'm sure
easily.
Most of you have heard of at some point. Not only for his many great bands, but also for his work in voice acting, video games, and film composition. The Chili Pepper slaying Renaissance man can almost single-handedly be credited as the progenitor of nu metal. Whether that's a crown he wants or not is neither here nor there. But his two most well-known projects, Mr. Bungle and Faith No More, served as the biggest inspirations to the genre. Faith No More themselves are a band with a lot of history pre-Mike Patton, though with his entrance to the band, he brought a much more eclectic and experimental touch to their sound. Let this go, oh, you got those in. I cannot stop giving. bringing out much more of the funk and hip-hop elements the band had buried within themselves. I mean, we've all heard Epic by now. It's been a staple of rock radio since before most of us were born.
This video is going to get me copyrighted. He's playing a
would be
lot
the infamous
of snippets
Mr. Bungle, cited as an influence by many, but most importantly by Korn as one of their key influences.
Another one of our inspirations were a band called Mr. Bungle. Yeah, right? And they were just doing that. You know, what's a,
I knew that's you know, where that sound came from. Yup.
What the hell is that?
The band's unorthodox take on rock and metal with hints of funk and opera was absolutely massive for the time, but most importantly for nu metal, it was the band's take on guitar playing, with heavy uses of dissonant and sometimes outright broken chords to assault the listener.
Love that song too.
You can hear this kind of thing all over nu metal, and Mr. Bungle is to thank for that. But with all that being said, I think it's time we look at the genre's real beginnings.
For better or worse, Rage Against the Machine seems to have planted the seeds for the genre that sprung up known as nu metal. My apologies.
Once the early...
Shut the fuck up, Tom Morello.
90s came around.
You disingenuous grifter shit.
Around, the world of music, especially rock and metal, would see a nearly overnight rejuvenation and shift never seen before or since. With the thriving underground scene hosting many innovative and interesting takes on genres, it was inevitable that it would eventually hit the mainstream. And on September 10th, 1991, that time had come. This overplayed piece of radio rock changed the world of music overnight. Smells Like Teen Spirit wasn't just an MTV hit. Nirvana had unintentionally ruined the careers of almost every 80s cock rock band and brought a new standard to what mainstream rock should sound like. Grunge took the world by storm, seeing the likes of Nirvana, Smashing Pumpkins, Alice in Chains, and Soundgarden to the center stage of the world of music. And only a year later, Nine Inch Nails would do the same thing with their groundbreaking EP, Broken.
That big in the Nine
This Inch also
Nails.
Ushered in a new it's wave of artists like Marilyn Manson and Prick, while bringing an even bigger spotlight to the 80s industrial bands that paved their path. What does any of this have to do with nu metal? Simple. Pop-focused radio rock anthems about drinking whiskey and banging underage groupies were out of fashion, and noisy, intense songs about politics, abuse, and trauma were in. The pretty boy heartthrobs who once dominated the industry were no longer viewed as demigods. The tortured artist and degenerating addict, they were the new icons. And it was this very same energy that came to metal music. As stated before, the underground metal scene was beginning to evolve in much the same way rock had, with heavier and more intense bands like Pantera, Machine Head, and Tool seeing some key success in the genre. Now, what would happen if we took just about every sound we've talked about today and threw it all into a blender? Well, you get this.
This video's gonna get you copyright claimed like a mother.
What Nirvana did for rock, Korn did for metal. When Blind came out, it just made everything that came before it feel extremely dated. There was something pure and fresh about the tortured and strange sound the band was playing with, combining hip-hop grooves, growling screams, low-tuned guitars, and melodic choruses. It all just worked. And exactly. Overnight, a new wave of bands creating sounds adjacent to Korn would pop up. And because of just how different the band's image and sound were, they ended up performing alongside metal, rock, and punk bands alike, garnering themselves a diverse and interesting fan base, finally becoming the centerpiece of an entirely new scene that had been brewing in the underground for nearly a decade.
Adidas wave.
Of all kinds of sound, you know? We grew up kind of in a, I guess you'd call it the hood, whatever. And our early roots, I think, musically come from a lot of different places, from disco to, you know, being in the beginning of new wave music. There's so much great music in all these genres. Why not?
See, and that's the great thing about, like, new metal, man. Like, when you think of America, how America is a melting pot of people, that's how new metal is, man. It's a melting pot of different genres, you know? It's not just rap. It's not just metal. It's like grunge, disco, funk, punk, new wave, like post-hardcore, like post-punk. It's so, bro, I'm telling you, man.
Just, you know.
If you know, you know.
The best of whatever you like and put it in and hopefully be able to do it so it's not so contrived, you know. If it's just because it was, for us, it was natural.
Once Korn hit the scene and became the new heroes of underground metal, a phenomenon I like to call the Adidas wave hit the music industry like a sack of bricks. Bands taking similar approaches to metal music started popping up left, right, and center, with Deftones, Limp Bizkit, and POD coming out of the woodwork. As the 90s went on, more and more bands taking different influences and genres into the mix also came to prominence, such as Orgy with their heavy synth pop influence and Coal Chamber with groove metal. Now, to get into all this in more detail,
See, this is unrelated, but I love the backgrounds and just transitions and everything that this guy uses. I don't know, it's just something I can't, that I'm really noticing throughout the video and stuff like that. Good on you, man. I know I sound like I'm kissing this guy's ass right now, but I'm like, damn it, dude. Well, it's like, I look at this video and I'm just like, damn it, man. There's more I could be doing with my content, bro.
It wasn't as instant as grunge. Korn and Deftones were the two biggest bands during the early days of nu metal, and both would see a fair amount of success upon their debut records, but wouldn't find that arena rock niche until their second and third records respectively.
Yeah,
for Korn, their first two albums were harsh, dark, and very much inspired by the popular grunge sound of the time. There was an alluring nature to the depravity and gloom that the band presented with their imagery and lyrics, and they would even become notorious for their trauma anthems like Daddy and Kill You, where Jonathan Davis would musically vomit his abusive past for all to hear. And, you know, I'm sure this little breakdown had just a little bit of influence on metalcore.
Oh, yeah. Especially with the chugga-chuggas. Like,
though, what would transform the band from underground legends to MTV heroes was their beloved third record, Follow the Leader.
Like, that's the thing, man. The palm muting, like, it's like... that palm muting just in that one song, man. You'd be surprised how many metalcore bands were really inspired by that to really even do their thing from that type of shit, man. Straight up. Just playing all the bangers, isn't it?
Follow the Leader was massive. It took the sound the band was famous for and cleaned it up to be much more accessible and polished, as well as turned up the hip-hop influence even higher, bringing on guests like Ice Cube, Trey Henderson, and even a young Fred Durst before Limp Bizkit was really put on the map. Follow the Leader and its follow-up Issues are probably Korn's best records, not only because they were massive, but being the most definitive and polished takes on the classic nu metal sound. Now, as for Deftones, their debut was much less dark and instead landed in a more neutral place, with the sound they started with being much more hip-hop influenced, with Gino loosely rapping over some of the tracks.
That and Engine Number 9 were really good. In Minus Blindfold, which is like one that doesn't get talked about as much, I'm telling you, absolute banger.
And using his trademark vocal style on others. Though the band would quickly change into something far different with their next two releases, taking the building blocks on their debut and bringing in a much stronger shoegaze and punk influence, with their second record, Around the Fur, skyrocketing the band to the mainstream.
See, and that's what I like about that second record, too, man. It's like, what I like about that second record, what made that so great, was basically, it was everything that Deftones was, like, from the demo tape to Adrenaline, to what they would literally be from that point and on to now. Like, that's a beautiful thing, man.
It was with this less dissident and edgy and more melodic and dreamy sound that would eventually lead the band to be held in a different regard than most other bands associated with nu metal, eventually leading to Deftones being branded as alternative metal, once their former genre became far too hated and toxic to be associated with. You know, because nu metal bands all have to be super try-hard and can't be good, right?
Okay, along the passage, downstairs, into the kitchen, open the cupboard, and yeah!
Where the classic nu metal iteration of Deftones would hit their peak would be with their third record, White Pony, a legendary and amazing album that, much like Follow the Leader, brought the genre to near perfection.
I've never heard this song before, but it actually sounds good. I'm gonna have to go back and listen to this. This is off their White Pony record, which I believe I've listened to at one point or another. So weird, I've never heard this one.
The atmosphere, musicianship, vocals, lyrics, everything about White Pony was light years ahead of almost everything else at the time, especially within nu metal, which, albeit is a bit juvenile of a genre.
No denying that.
It's just one of those days where you don't want to wake up. Everything is fucked. Everybody sucks.
I do plan to explore this record in far greater detail in another video.
That is so awesome.
But needless to say,
I have to wonder if he found this somewhere or if he did this shit himself. If he did this himself, oh my God, Gray Matt, you are the man. You are the GOAT. You're great. That is awesome. That is high quality editing if you managed to do that shit yourself. That is wild.
Wanna wake up! Everything is fucked! Everybody sucks!
I do plan to explore this record in far greater detail in another video, but needless to say, if you're at all into heavy music, White Pony is required listening.
Yeah, I don't think that's actually Korea. I think he kind of got that wrong a little bit on this. It was a bit of an oversight.
With the success of Deftones and Korn in the mid to late 90s, they had their fair share of small imitators. But more importantly, bigger bands would start to emulate and adopt the nu metal sound. Bands like Sepultura and Machine Head began incorporating lower tunings and funk and hip-hop elements to keep
up. Which, crazy enough, people say that was one of like Machine Head's worst points, like, of their, you know, of their career. I don't think so, man. I like that record they made. I thought it was really good, especially their cover of, The Police's Message in a Bottle. That was awesome. That was cool.
Up with the times. As the 90s began to come to a close, we saw nu metal split off into some pretty diverse subgenres. You had the more classic sound of the previously mentioned bands, but also the rap metal variant of the genre, one that became extremely popular with Limp Bizkit and
Linkin
Park.
Sam Rivers is an underrated
bass player, almost every other band from the genre at the time.
He is amazing.
With Limp Bizkit starting off in a more traditional territory for the sound.
See, and here's the thing. If you want to say Limp Bizkit sucks, listen to this fucking record, then try to come back and tell me that Limp Bizkit sucks. Because I guarantee you, the only reason you say that is you listen to Nookie and Break Stuff, and then that was just your generalization of the band right there. Listen to this fucking record, and then try to come back and tell me they suck.
It was only with their later records that they evolved into the frat boy metal we've all come to love and hate today.
That's the thing. I didn't like Roland. I didn't like Break Stuff. I didn't like Nookie. Those songs, ugh. As much as I love Limp Bizkit's music, those songs I really didn't like. Just like Twisted Transistor in, I don't even remember the other type of fucking song. I don't even remember what was the other. Oh, Coming Undone. That was it. From Korn. Like, yeah. Even though those were like the most popular songs of those respective bands, I did not like them. It just was not feeling them. And I don't even think it was because they were like mainstream, because there are plenty of mainstream songs by both those bands that I like a lot. But those songs, they really didn't do it for me.
Other bands of this nature would be the previously mentioned POD, who's often conflated as the Christian Limp Bizkit.
I've never heard that before.
As well as bands like Papa Roach and Head PE. And while this style of the genre become the most well-known and, despised, other takes on the sound would be accepted with much more enthusiasm, like the heavier, more aggressive variants of Mudvayne. And most importantly, Slipknot. Well, it's easy to look at the gimmicky nature of these bands with their spirit Halloween aesthetic.
But see, that's the great thing about them, about Slipknot, though. That's the great thing about gimmicky. That's one of my biggest problems with bands today now. You listen to any of these modern metal bands, are they talented? Yes. But guess what? They're boring as fuck, because it takes a lot more than talent to just really reach people. It takes a lot more than just making so-called great music to just reach people. You know, you got to have a personality to you. You got to have something that makes you stand out from the rest of the crowd. Bands today do not have that. It's all just dudes who look like they worked at Hot Topic playing metal or rock. That's literally all it is. It's, come on, man. Like people criticize the gimmicky nature of these bands, but I'm like, you know what? The gimmicky nature, the freaking Halloween Town freaking mask and shit like that, and jumpsuits that, oh shit, I hit my desk, and jumpsuits that Slipknot wore, the fucking little a glitterized Adidas tracksuit that Jonathan Davis wore, or the freaking red baseball cap and freaking cargo shorts and a t-shirt that Fred Durst wore. As simple as that is, that made him stand out from other people because they weren't just, you know, they weren't just a bunch of random dudes playing metal or rock. So, yeah, it's like you can make fun of how silly these bands look, but I'm like, that's what makes them stand out, unlike the bands of today, which the bands of today could really stand to seriously learn from and maybe not wonder why people are just tuning out of their shit so much and listening more to, like, hip-hop, because hip-hop is doing more to innovate the genre than what they're doing. You know, you got people like a Ghost Mane. You got people like an MGK. You know, as much as you not may not like MGK, same at Ronnie Radke. You got people like a Ronnie Radke who have a look, who have a persona that is very superstar, larger than life. Like, that's what you mean? And that's the biggest problem. And again, that's the biggest problem that that's not only just with rock and metal. That's the biggest problem with a lot of things today. Hell, even you could take wrestling, for example. Nobody stands out anymore. It's like they're either just carbon copies of something else, or they're just dudes who flip, flop, and fly and do technical wrestling and expect you to like them just because of the wrestling. Just like bands today expect you to like them just because of the little noodle crap that they can do on guitar. Like, it's stupid. Have something that makes you stand out, for fuck's sakes.
Like, many would just become a flash in the pan with huge overnight success, but oftentimes short-lived careers. Slipknot is the obvious outlier here, becoming bigger than nu metal itself and gaining a rabid following that would prop the band up as one of the biggest metal bands of all time. However, one of the more forgotten takes on nu metal was the industrial side of the genre. Industrial was the other dark and dissident genre that dominated the late 90s, so crossover was almost inevitable. And yeah, from this collaboration of sounds came bands like Dope.
Dope being, of course, one of the cringier parts of that nu metal scene, but yeah.
Orgy. And most famously, Static X.
Rest in peace, Wayne Static, by the way.
Now, there were plenty of bands that covered this sound, but outside of a handful of artists, they were all mostly forgettable. But in the case of bands like Orgy and Static X, they both did things that would set them apart from the rest of the nu metal pack. Orgy is one of the most criminally underrated bands of this genre, cursed by the fact that they came out during the last dying breaths of the genre's heyday. But their upbeat and synth-pop-inspired take on the genre was something very special, dropping much of the callous edginess of the genre in favor of a fun and catchy song structure. All this being wrapped in a cheesy cyberpunk aesthetic. As for Static X, well, they took the opposite approach. The band was relentlessly heavy for the time, relying on fast-paced drum loops and syncopated guitar parts, topped with Wayne Static's trademark vocals. And with all this, the band would see some major success right out the gate, maintaining relatively high popularity until the late 2000s, when the band would dissolve and Wayne would sadly delve deeper into his addiction, tragically overdosing in 2014. While I'm skipping over a vast amount of bands, these are just a few of the ones I thought were the most important to talk about from nu metal's massive wave of popularity. But like anything that comes to rise, it inevitably flew too close to the sun.
I detested nu metal. I thought it kind of set us back to the Stone Age as far as rock's concerned.
Nu metal's the...
I kind of want to go back to that real quick.
I detested nu metal. I thought it kind of set us back to the Stone Age as far as rock's concerned.
Shut the fuck up, Gerard Way. I'm like, buddy, you didn't exactly... Like, the only reason why your band got popular is because fucking teenage girls got fucking wet to your little fucking emo look. You didn't do anything to make yourself superstars. You were just superstars with horny little teenage girls. Fuck you.
Nu metal.
Sorry if I had to get a little, you know, bit graphic there or even a bit defensive, but I'm just like, oh, you're worried about the genre being set back. Get your dumb ass out of here.
Decline was one of the quickest I have ever seen in the music industry. While most phenomena tend to die out with a whimper and slowly fade away, nu metal did the opposite. During its height of popularity during the turn of the century, the genre was quickly left in the dust. Yeah. While we still saw groundbreaking and huge records like Linkin Park's Hybrid Theory see release, other flavors of rock and metal began to pop up and quickly replace nu metal. All of this is down to two key factors, at least in my opinion. And those would be oversaturation and media assassination. Like anything that gets
Big. Because you've had publications that were bearing it ever since the beginning. And, you know, people being sheep like they are, instead of just having their own thoughts and opinions, are going to naturally, if you're calling something garbage long enough, people are going to, like, start to see that and think, oh, maybe this is garbage, you know, because I don't have a mind of my fucking own. So, yeah, I'm going to think of this as garbage just because this one person or this other publication that I happen to like said it's garbage. Yeah. And then, yeah, oversaturation, like he also said. Too many people wanting to get on the train, man. Which is understandable since it was a thriving genre. It was a popular genre, but as with anything, man, oversaturation will kill it.
Market will inevitably get oversaturated with watered-down knockoff bands doing little more than playing on the cliches of the genre. And with the music media machine pumping out article after article attacking the genre and denouncing its fan base.
Sometimes it might not even be the fault of the bands. It's kind of almost more of the fault of... It's really more of the fault of, like, the record labels, because they see a band like Korn getting huge, and maybe it was a band... And maybe it's a band that, like, wasn't nu metal initially, but since they saw success of a Limp Bizkit, success of a Korn, record labels were probably like, hey, you need to start making this type of music if you want to stay in business with us and make any kind of money. So that probably was a big part of it.
Many bands formerly associated with the genre would begin to brand themselves under different genres themselves and separate their names from nu metal itself. Most famously, I could point to Deftones, as I already have a few times now, or a band like System of a Down, who would also do the same thing in later years. Despite how popular many of the bands were, nu metal was...
I never heard much of System of a Down really trying to distance themselves from nu metal. But then again, doesn't mean it's not true, but... I don't know. I mean, I've heard Chino definitely do it, but yeah, I've never really heard. I mean, I've even heard Korn, or at least Jonathan Davis, to some degree, really try to distance himself from it.
Never cool. It had always been met with scorn and hatred by music journos, mainstream media, and popular artists alike. Everyone was itching to take pot shots, and after a while, it led to the consensus that nu metal was terrible and nothing good ever came from it. And
because people are fucking sheep, they don't have minds of their own. So naturally, yeah, that happens. Like I just said, something like that keeps happening and keeps happening. People are going to come to that consensus, unfortunately.
Once social media came around, this sentiment was continually pushed by many of the tastemakers of the time. Also, cheesy songs like Bring Me to Life didn't do any favors to the scene at large.
Oh, of course not. It's like, this may be a hot take, but I don't think Evanescence, I don't like Evanescence. All right, well, then again, this might not be a hot take. That I don't think that counts as a hot take. I think that's just more my opinion. But, yeah, I never found Evanescence to be that great. Amy Lee's hot as hell, but aside from that...
Another contributing factor was the newfound popularity at the time of emo, post-hardcore, and meteoric rise of metalcore.
Yeah. Crab
the
Warped
Tour scene
crab
itself
core.
Would quickly become the new status quo of alternative culture, and eventually a very similar scapegoat for many of nu metal's old critics. And with that, as quickly as it came, it went. A hated memory of the past, regardless of the many innovations that it gave us.
There's definitely some Fieldy-inspired stuff.
Mix it with stepping, and then it kind of sounds bigger.
Are you influenced by Ryan Martin?
Yeah, it's obvious.
Oh, yep, definitely Ryan Martin. I forgot to mention that, for sure. Oh, didn't mean the full screen there. Well, I don't know what the fuck that happened.
Yeah. This
Burr-burr-dang
thing is now a meme. This guy definitely stepped over all limits which were before him, and managed to implement a number of new techniques, and not only just pure techniques, but also ways musically playing some scales and notes, which had not been used before him.
Now,
and that's the thing, man. Like, one thing I like about nu metal, especially being someone who's played guitar, who's played instruments before in their life, when that came around, it really kind of showed that you didn't have to really play the sort of notes and, like, scales and, you know, you didn't have to know pentatonics. You didn't have to know any of that shit to play guitar, you know. You didn't have to, you didn't have to know the pentatonic scale or any of that bullshit just to be able to play guitar. You could just riff on some shit and make something. I like that. That's one thing I really always liked about nu metal and punk, because they represented not having to be tethered to being like a virtuoso of a guitar player or of like a musician, you know, for someone like me who wasn't really all that musically inclined.
Over the years, the stink around nu metal has slowly begun to fade away, with many of the key bands seeing a resurgence of popularity and success, achieving legacy status, but also many different artists have become taking major influence from it as well, and not just in heavy music either. Across the musical spectrum, people like Ghostmane or bands like Vain FM, Crossfaith, Sworn In, Meishi, Smile, Spite, they've all cited nu metal as a massive influence, and you can hear it directly in the music that they make. And on top of this, many of the old voices who decry the genre no longer are relevant, and a younger generation is now discovering these bands without any of the bias. And this has all led to the genre finally being given the credit it deserves and being viewed for what it actually was. Now, was nu metal cheesy, try-hard, and outright terrible at times?
Of course.
Oh, fuck yeah, it was. But I mean, what genre hasn't been like that?
Right?
In reality, nu metal was hated and derided because it came out during a time when experimentation wasn't viewed with as much enthusiasm as it is now. And many people took themselves far too seriously to get behind the more goofy and strange elements of the sound and aesthetic. Something else I think that really set nu metal apart was, it was never really part of any specific subculture or scene. It was this weird amalgamation of many different things coming together. So your average mainstream audience or pretentious and insulated subculture or subgroup couldn't really get into it. And due to a mixture of classism and outright pride, I think many people just hated it for appealing to an often forgotten and neglected group of people who are more eclectic in their tastes. The people who are often looked at as weird outcasts who didn't really fit into the more traditional subcultures. But with all that being said, nu metal was pretty damn good, and if you haven't delved into it before, there are some gems buried in it. You might have to dig for them, but it's well worth the effort. Subscribe, support me on Patreon, follow me on Twitter. I'll see you in the next video.
All right, man. So that's the vid right there. That was great, man. Gray Mads, an amazing fucking content creator. I would definitely recommend, you know, everything like he said. Hey, maybe support the guy on Patreon if you wish. Subscribe to the guy's YouTube channel. Check out this guy's content, man. I mean, even if you may not like this video, check out some of the other stuff, you know, kind of like this stuff right here, you know? Yeah, check out more of this guy's stuff. Yeah, man, because he makes some genuine good-ass content, man. And I wish that I had discovered this guy much earlier in life, but nevertheless, man, let me know what you guys thought about this video in the comment section below. You know, do you agree that nu metal was always good? Or do you think the opposite? Yeah, again, let me know in the comments down below and also what you thought of this reaction. And for that, if you want to see, more reaction videos, if you want to see let's plays like I'm currently doing with Shadow the Hedgehog, Sleeping Dogs Definitive Edition in, God willing, if, you know, rock stars stop, you know, wasting my time, then maybe, or if I can even somehow get a more stable version of the game, again, we may go back to GTA San Andreas Definitive Edition. Otherwise, I don't know. Who knows? But if you also want to see my tier list videos, my reviews of things such as movies, TV, video games, music, maybe even books in the future, and just a bunch of other stuff, because I don't want to list it all. I do a whole bunch of other different stuff, because it's like I say at the end of every video, I'm not married to just one topic of content. I don't do just one style of content, because, you know, I like to do a whole bunch of different things. I like a whole bunch of different stuff, and it keeps me interesting, and it keeps me fresh as a content creator. It keeps my love for content creation fresh, and that's something I would recommend to other content creators out there as well. But with all that being said, this has been your boy, TW Booty Hunter, giving you guys another banger. And I will see you guys next time.
Thank you for being an ass and not watching the whole video. You didn't listen to a single damn thing I said. Thank you for being an ass, only hearing what you wanted to, and getting butt hurt like the sensitive little bitch you are. Thank you for being an ass.